So, welcome to No Shame, episode 85. I have my man here, one of the Avengers, right? So, this is an Avenger team getting beat up there. You know this, don't you, John? Yeah? Me, you, who am I missing? Paul Allroy,
yeah.
Dean Scurdy.
Yeah, yeah, Terry McMahon.
Yeah. How could I forget fucking Terry?
Maverick Sabre.
And it was the election result day. And I swear to God, man, I didn't give a bollocks about them elections, only you. Right? I remember I was Instagram and tweeting, I was Facebooking, but fucking, you're not from my district, you know what I mean? But I was still going, if he's in your constituency, fucking vote for this cunt.
Yeah.
But I was in Paris and I was just looking, I was trying to get Wi-Fi, I had to go and get coffee to get the Wi-Fi. And then I seen just a video of you, man, getting hoisted up in the air by your comrades. And I was like, up out of that. I was fucking delighted for you, man.
So that was mad as well, John. I always do this as well. I look at the people around me when something good's going down.
Yeah.
And like when someone's looking at a photograph, they're always looking at the person in the middle. I'm looking at the people around them.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you want to see the people, if you have a look back at that video, you see the people's faces that are around me.
I know, yeah.
It's
so
like,
happy for you.
Yeah, so happy for me. Yeah. And that's a good little tip to do. Have a look at the people around your faces.
Man, it's crazy, man, because we were talking about this, man. Just talking about politics and you were just thinking about it.
Yeah.
You were only thinking about it last August, now you're fucking elected.
And that's like...
You can do anything, man. You will be president.
I believe
I'm telling you, man. I think you're going to be president next run. Paddy Powers are going to lose money, man. Yeah. I'm putting a bet on it, I swear to God, man.
We were downstairs talking and John was talking about putting 100 quid on and John's like, 100 quid? £2,000 though.
£2,000 because you get 100 grand back, man.
100 grand. Think
and
about
then you be met up, you know what I mean? You're buying a little bit of land. That's what I've been thinking.
Think about this, right? This might be the solve to all of our problems, lads. Yeah. We all get together.
Yeah.
We get along with £2,000 out of credit union. Yeah. We stick around the party power. Thing.
Yeah.
We wait until the election comes up and
everybody campaign
for their own 100
grand. That's it, for your own money. You're doing it for yourself. So you're motivated. That's how you motivate the people.
Do you know what I mean? You can imagine going to the party power after that, couldn't you?
Oh, God.
You know what I mean? Party power would have a hit on me.
I'm telling you. Man, you're gonna do it, man. You're gonna do. Look, you're doing everything, man. Look what you're. What age are you now, buddy?
31.
You're 31, man. What? You have your own gym. You're in the fucking UFC. You have your own podcast now that's flourishing, and now you're an elective activist.
And two boys.
And you've two little boys. Jesus, like two man, sons. That's mad. What you're much rather. And especially, man, from the knockbacks you've had in your life.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like,
but
these what made you. I know that, but I'm saying a lot of people fold under that sort of pressure. And then you know, obviously, what happened with the UFC and having to stop MMA and having to rebuild yourself and find almost a new identity in a way. Like that's amazing, man. What you're doing. You are an inspiration to everybody. That's why when I saw that video, I'm telling you, man, I was watery-eyed in Paris and I was just delighted for you. I was like, yes, yes, someone good got through. Someone, one of us, you know what I mean? One of us, yes, speaking for us. Because I know you're going to do that job for the likes of us, you know what I mean?
Watery-eyed in Paris, that could be a film.
Yeah.
Watery-eyed. Yeah.
They had a similar one, Midnight in Paris, but whatever.
He had 12 whiskeys in it, but that's what
you know,
how did the shows go? That had to be a mad experience.
That was a mad experience.
Listen, if you haven't gone and seen this show, now I'm not just prompting this because John's sitting here, but because I said it loads of times off it.
Yeah.
It's incredible, John. And you know, it was a great experience. I got to go there, right? One day, someone's like, well, like, oh, no, fuck, I'm going to go on my own.
Yeah.
I went on my own, had a nice point and all before it, sat down, watched the show.
Yeah, that's good.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
I really, like, I was with people beside me just enjoying it and the energy of it.
In the Civic, you were
the
there.
Emotion,
in the, you joined us in the after show.
At the end of it,
Yeah, man. Great shows in the Civic, man. Were really special shows because the Tala audience really got to play, man. Like, probably more than anybody.
Yeah.
They really got it. And Eve and all down there and everyone who worked there, brilliant people, man, because they got the crowds out, huge working class audiences out to see you play. It's very hard to do this.
Absolutely.
And they were selling out, you know?
Yeah.
We're actually going back there on the 5th of November. Remember the Civic, they've invited us back because the shows went so great.
If you
know?
Haven't seen the show, a little glimpse on it. It's the idea of, it's like listening to somebody going out on a session and it's the same energy.
Yeah.
I was a little bit excited. I was like, geez, where are we going?
That's the idea. Is make people fucking go.
I know. And it brings you up on this big like... And then... Mm. Yeah, and then the mad thing
what
is...
What goes up must come down.
That is exactly what happens because I've like... We've been there myself.
Yeah.
You could tell that you've been there yourself as well. You know
it's structured
I mean?
In the way that about drugs and drink, which is they make you go fly high as a kite and then you go crashing down. And the play is structured like that. The beats are like that. So let's go up and everybody's so excited. And then boom, a counter punch.
Yeah.
And they're going, what the fuck is happening now? You know what I mean? Because I want them to believe it's one thing and then it transforms into another. And then it's like whiplash because it goes back and forward, you know?
Have you read Dublin 7?
Dublin 7, I absolutely loved it.
Absolutely amazing. amazing.
Loved it, man. That was, it's like one of my favourite books. And it's like, I read that, Frankie Gaffney's book, for anybody who doesn't know at home. Yeah.
We actually done an interview with Frankie Gaffney.
He's deadly. I love Frankie Gaffney. And he's a good friend of mine, man. He's backed me up a lot, man. I backed him up a lot. And he's both of us got ourselves in a lot of trouble. a lot of trouble. But I read his book, man, when I was off the session. And I avoided reading the book for a long time because Frankie's a friend of mine. And I'm ruthless with me honesty. I won't say something's good if it's not. And I just avoided it, you know. And then I said, I'll just give it a read. And I was off the session. And oh my God, I was off the drink. I was like 2 months, you know, from January. And I was like reading it. And he was like bringing you into a fucking early house and into six in the morning. You could like, you could smell the session. Like that's how good the writing was. You could smell it, but it was brilliant. And even the tiny little details of things like there's 1.4 in a bag of Coke, but there's not nowadays, but there was back in the early, you know what I mean? Back at that time, there was one, but I need to weigh it up and everything, all these different things, man. It was just so real and authentic. It was just brilliant, man. Like, I never read anything like it. Like, because all, you know, people who are writing books are not from where Frankie comes from.
Yeah.
And Frankie now is a PhD, you know. But the people don't write, so they don't know that world. But it's, you know, someone who, you know, someone straight away knows this world, and it's brilliant. Like, I thought of it as a film. I thought that's a great film or a TV series.
This is what
I
was thinking.
You know,
yeah,
like, because it's so good, man. But unfortunately, Frankie has had a really bad rub of it, man. You know, he's someone I think he believes in total equality, but he stood up against certain things that are not things stand up against now, and he's been ostracised in the media, like, because he used to regularly write articles for different outlets and different newspapers and that. And all those jobs are gone. He's been desecrated, basically. His work, everything, man. He can't get a book published now and all because he just stood up for stuff that he believes in.
I was saying to him, even the idea, because you know, because you can go in, like it was Teddy that said this to me and reminded me of it, and then the idea of just thinking back through it is like that. When you turn up with loads of motivation and loads of enthusiasm and loads of there's lads waiting for you. They know what to do with you.
100%.
You know what I mean? This contract, this is the best one you're going to get, of course. How could you get better than this?
This
is better than Anne.
Maybe
it is, you know, because you're a bit still vulnerable.
Yeah, man. Man, there's so many sharks out there.
So that's I think that on his book, like on this, such a great book. Now, the idea of it, but if he could make a film out of this, now, I won't say it'd be love, hate, kind of wise,
no,
but
it'd be that world, I suppose.
That world, yeah.
But man, it's a way different lens to that world. It's an exploration of the culture as well. You know what I mean? And also a time period, you know what I mean? It's a period early noughties, you know what I mean? And I think there's an authenticity to it. Like, I mean, if you look at like the early noughties going up to around 2003 and 4, that was the last breath of great dance music as well. You know what I mean? Like, and you know, you had the last bit of Tiesto when he was good. Now he's fucking doing pop. You know what I mean?
But
you were sort of at the peak of the dance, because when you're in 2003, you're still listening to stuff from 8 years ago. It's 95. So you're in the clubs and you're listening to all the 90s up to now, and how it's steady dancing, you're in the set, you know what I mean? Like, so it's that culture.
When it comes on,
like, man, I was just listening to fucking I was on the bus the other day in the town, and I was listening to Tiesto, that one, what's it called, Solarium or Celine, one of them ones, man. It's a trance tune and it's a 9 minute version live. And I swear to God, I was just like, whoa. And you know, when I dropped one of these builders, when I dropped, I was like, but they're living, Jesus. You wouldn't need fucking drugs if you just put this up loud enough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you're going like this, that era's over now.
And new earphones,
it's all,
that shit's different now.
It's all cheesy pop now and all the all listening, and you're like, well, just shut the fuck
up. Going back to Frankie's book there, there's a part in the book, right, that's mental, that you said that you felt sick. I messaged him and said I had to put the book down when he's talking about.
I put it down. I swear to
it's
God,
coming
I put it down.
Off
well.
An ecstasy,
I put it down
right?
one night. I just went, nah, it's gone. I had to pick it up next week. Then.
Sick.
Yeah, man. Oh man.
I had this sickness rolling
description.
Around in my stomach.
It's just every little thought in your head. You're going, what? This fella knows what he's talking about. Like,
definitely. Yeah. So obviously you've been there. Like, France, Germany, Australia.
Yeah, so Paris, New York, Australia, Sydney and Melbourne over there. And going to Liverpool with it, going to London with it, going
Liverpool
to the North with it, going to Belfast, we're doing Derry, doing all around Ireland. Going loads of places. Canada now looks like they want it, and maybe back to New York next year, and then talk of getting on the national stage next year as well at the Abbey, so it's all looking
good.
Well, the audience are really getting the man, and we were told by lots of venues that they wouldn't take in this show because, you know, their audiences wouldn't like it. But what happened was it just spread like wildfire, because we do these post-show discussions, but you took part, and thanks for that. Mm-hmm. And it's great, because I said the aim is when you go to a local community, pick a local hero. So that's what I've done everywhere I went. So I picked you when I went to Tala. I picked people down the country. You know, I do a bit of research in the Midlands, who's the local hero, and I get the version of you there, you know. Good. I did that all around Ireland. I did it abroad as well. So the post-show discussions really hit off, and venues start just ringing up saying, "This, we want them, we want them, we want the festival to start, we want them. And this is a show with no backing behind it, no fun, no nothing. Just me and an independent producer, like, that's it. And there's no tricks, you know what I mean? It's just me in a fucking chair telling a story in a shanicky way, you know what I mean? Like, so,
me and you,
like you and Robin.
My man. What's
that? Australia, New York. Yeah, what was the other one? Paris.
Paris, yeah. Like, the Paris one was mad because they were all very, like, mustache kind of tweezers, you know, like these, you know, artists. And I didn't realise I was put in an art gallery in the middle of the art gallery. They built a stage in this art gallery in the Irish Cultural Centre, and it was fucking deadly, man, deadly. And it was an honour to go over there. Only huge acts go over there, and kind of big artists, like real artists, so that was an honour. But when I went over, it was the art surrounding me was the art from this Irish artist, and he said, his name has slipped me right now in this moment, but he's a very kind of revolutionary rebel artist, right, who escaped Ireland and went to Paris. And he had this great saying, which was, she put me, the artistic director, who, again, I'm forgetting her name, she put me in around this art because she thought, my message is very much like this artist, which was an honour, because he had this great saying, which was, I don't beat around the bush, I burn the bush. And I went, that's a fucking great
that's
line. And my line. I was doing the performance in the middle of all his art, which was just, it was an honour, like, you know, this great activist art. And the Paris audience were strange, like, there were some Irish as well, they were strange, like, they wouldn't, you know, they didn't get the humour at times, and then they'd laugh at stuff they didn't want to laugh at. But I was, like, at the end, not really sure what he thought of it. And I got a standing ovation, and I was like, shit. And they were standing for about 5 minutes, like. But then we were doing the post-show discussion, and this fella jumps up, fucking cunt, fucking, fucking, yeah, fucking. And he was meldy, right? And I said, what's this fella's problem, you know? And he was a real posh act, you know, you fuck off, right? And I was like, all right, I get why you don't like it then. And turns out he says he's from Coolock, this fella. And he was nearly fighting with this girl, because a girl jumps up from Tala, and she says, well, I fucking loved it. And just leave it out. And he's like, you fair shut play, your fucking...
What a fucking time.
Yeah, and she, and he was like, you shut your fucking mouth now. Shut it now. And I was on the stage talking to him, because I was trying to get him up. Let's have a discussion while you don't like it. I'm interested, you know?
Knock, one or the other.
But then when she start, yeah, but when he started doing that to her, then I said, don't fucking say that to her now. So don't get fucking aggressive with her. Get the fuck out for yourself. But it turns out he's from Coolock, he says. Now, very strange Coolock accent. Hello. But someone who must have lost his roots now.
He must have been fucked out of his
estate. But listen, I met his mate later on that night in the bar, right? This last bar in Paris that on a Wednesday night that's open late, right? And this Turkish fella meets him outside just having a fag. I was mouthy drunk, drinking a lot of whiskey. And he comes, hey, John, I seen your play tonight. And I said, oh, how are you, man? Oh, Jesus, you come to see me play? Yeah, my friend, Matthew, he came to play, brought me to the play, but he'd got very drunk, drink like 3 bottles of wine before he went in, and he's the guy that ran out of your play. I said, oh shit. No, I said, where is he now? Was he in the bar? I wanted to meet him. Yeah. You know what I mean? Just have the crack out.
Want a drink and wine? Oh, yeah. We're going to agree with
him. And he says, no, he got home. He needs to sleep. He got very drunk. I said, okay. I said, listen. I said, do you have a phone? I said, WhatsApp him. So I did a little video. What's up, Matthew? Just like having the crack
out. Never came back, did he?
Listen, I said, give him me number. I said, I want to know why he didn't like the place. So he texted me the other day. Sorry, Tom, so I was so drunk. This is Matthew and blah, blah, blah. And God, Nick Coolock never left me and all that. Which I don't know what that means. Like he's blaming Coolock on his outburst. I don't know.
Because
I'm from Coolock and
bedroom.
I'm not fucking doing outbursts.
He probably woke up in a box bedroom in Coolock one day.
Listen, man.
Yeah,
he was there for the weekend or something.
There for the weekend, yeah. Got breakfast.
He was traumatized by it.
Yeah.
So
this is part of
mad.
Me now.
Yeah. So it's mad, man. Just a mad experience, man.
I say they have to be like, because every single he brings a crazy little experience.
Oh man, yeah. Totally, man. We've had people getting very angry over stuff, and people loving it, people thanking me. Like one woman stood up and she cried, and she said in Ballymun, and she said, look, Thank you so much for this, because I never heard anybody talk about Letter Frack. Because Letter Frack, the industrial school, which was like the San Quentin or Alcatraz of industrial schools, is a part of the play. I go into that and the family history and that. And she said, my brother went to Letter Frack. And he always talked about it to the day he died. And when I went over and he was on his deathbed, he wouldn't stop talking about Letter Frack. And he said, no one, everybody forgets about Letter Frack. And she said, you're the first person I've heard in public discourse talk about Letter Frack like this. I said, thank you very much. Like, so I've had really, like...
Know what that is. So what is that again?
Letter Frack was an industrial school. So, like, 220,000 Irish people went through the industrial school system. And a load of them were just taken in for no reason, you know, maybe missing one day in school or robbing an apple or whatever. Okay. And they were sexually abused on a mass scale. And Letter Frack was like the Alcatraz. It was on the very edge of Connemara. Only the coast was this direction. And this is... back in the day, maybe it would take 7 or 8 hours to get from Dublin to there, and there's no way out, you know. And children were playing and simply murdered at times, you know what I mean? And this is not far from the tomb home where all the babies were found using
for slavery kind of nearly in a way.
Absolutely, like, yeah, absolutely. I've heard like stories, man, that are just actually unbelievable. I've interviewed so many people and so many victims, so many survivors, because that's what they are, they're survivors. This is one of the greatest shames of our country's history of the last 100 years since we became a free state, you know. So this is something I found was very important that I had to include into the play, you know. And it's only in a recent history, man, the industrial schools set up and the Magdalen Lodges where the women were abused just as bad. They only finished up in the late 70s, early 80s, really fizzled out. And this was simply down to a very simple thing, man, is when we got a free state status, we start giving the Catholic Church great power because we've seen...
They were the investors. And we've seen
Catholicism as a sort of way of differentiating between us and the English. They're Protestant, we're Catholic. And we give them so much power, man, and you know, power corrupts. The absolute power corrupts. You know, so they had absolute power and free reign, man. Like, they did crazy stuff, like, you know, stuff with they allowed British scientists to experiment on children in the 30s, and this is our Catholic Church done this, and the nuns done this. And you're talking about, like, I think I'm convinced the heroin epidemic of the 80s, a huge part to play with that was these abuse survivors who were looking for a way to heal themselves.
Absolutely.
And then what happens, man, what people don't talk about...
Drugs is a huge part of
to numb the pain, but what they don't talk about is the generational impact of trauma. So if it doesn't get dealt with within the person itself, they carry it on to their kids.
Their
kids carry it on to their grandkids and so on and so forth. And I have this in my own family. I see the family trauma being carried through, man. You know what I mean? And these are the things people don't want to talk about. We want to just get drunk and have a laugh and whatever. And we deal with things with a sense of humour as Irish people, which is a great way of doing it. But we just sweep too much stuff under the rug. And what happens is you start internalising stuff and you're unconscious, man. If you look at... what we're conscious of and what's the unconscious, there's a huge difference. So what we're conscious of is the iceberg that we can see, but the iceberg goes down way further than what we can see, and that's the unconscious. And if you keep stuff and everything down to the unconscious, what happens is there's an implosion or an explosion.
Something's gonna
happen to you, it's gonna combust, or it's gonna explode onto the others, or both, man. You know what I mean? So we have to address this stuff.
You said you've seen this in your own family, so we'd see this as well, and it's kind of frustrating, isn't it? Because it's like the patient I'm down, we're trying to grab them, and you'd be saying to me, just cop on, it's grand, leave the past in the fucking past.
It's not that easy.
No. And they treat their kids like kids, but for so long that their kids are now adults.
And
it continues on. And I know your kid will always be your kid, but then it gets to a stage where it's like, say a mother wouldn't go out to work because the kids would have to be minded, but then this can stay for a while, and then the kids are 18 and 19, and all of a sudden you have like, but I can't, I have to go home and make the thing for the kids. You don't have kids anymore.
Well, they're hanging on to that as well, and hanging on to, like, sometimes the parents don't want the kids to grow.
This is what I mean.
Because they have their role of a parent.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's a bit of security in themselves psychologically, you know? The problem with doing that with children now, there's a new sort of phenomenon of children who are grown into adults now are not becoming adults. And it's actually called, I think it's called, post-adolescent adults. So what in this psychological world now, what they're talking about is a lot of the youth of the day are not becoming adults now until they're like mid-20s. Because of social media, because of the games, the online and all this sort of stuff, that it's kind of, they're not going out living life as much, their life experiences, and they're in their own world so much that they don't get to develop their brain, to get dopamine hits from likes and love hearts and all this kind of stuff. So there's this post-adolescent thing, adult thing, you know? And I see it all around when I see it in my own family and they're not being able to grow up, man. Like, the thing, I think the most freeing thing as an individual is taking responsibility for yourself, okay? Now, there's this sort of, you get these narratives from a more conservative right wing, oh, lace up your own boots and all that, right? Whatever. Listen, when people are oppressed, okay, I'm all for people understanding they're oppressed, figuring out they're oppressed, realizing they are oppressed. If they realize they're a victim of oppression, then they can light a fire under themselves, a spark, a kick up the hole, a poker, all right? But the important thing is way more important, man. And I come from one of the most discriminated against people in all this country. And I'm telling you this for a fact, anybody out there listening, you have to never, ever adopt a victim mentality. And we're all guilty of doing that. Travellers, yeah. Working class people, you know, if you're in a home, a broken home, we can adapt a victim mentality, and that will justify the reason why we're failing in life, man. But we don't realise this thing called life is so short, yeah. And you're going to waste so many fucking years, man, and it's not fucking worth it.
Nope.
It's not worth it. I was only talking to Robin on the way. We all have barriers, okay? So if you come from a working class background, if you're a traveller, if you come in here or there, your mother or father's this and that, what? You have another barrier, maybe two barriers more than someone in posh rock. Right, but they're only barriers. They're not you in a padded cell with a straitjacket, with something stuffed in your mouth, with a blindfold, handcuffs, and being completely helpless. They're barriers you can jump over. Okay, a little bit more work is required, but if you're afraid of hard work, you're never going to get anywhere, man.
Definitely.
You know what I mean? Like,
I think that, and that is lacking, because it's like Instagram generation, yeah, if you must. You know what I mean?
It's a generation of narcissists.
Yeah.
And everything, and everybody's presenting a different version of themselves online. They're not being real online, you know what I mean? They're not, this is like what they hoped they had, what they wished they were. Even with all these filters and all these women and all, you see them out in the street and you're going, who the fuck are you? You have a face like a black bag. You know what I mean? Or a used condom. You know what I mean? Like, who are you? You know what I mean? Like, and the same with the fellas, they're as bad, yeah, for fuck's sake.
That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, and this Love Oil people. These fellas with six packs and all, they have a keg like me.
This is mental. You know what
I
mean? Like,
I don't know how
that?
They're doing this,
no,
man.
What's going on?
And Love Island, man.
Yeah, like what?
I would rather stick needles in my eyes.
Love Asylum. That's
what it should be called. To that, man.
Love Asylum is what
it's
it should be called.
Crazy,
you know I mean?
Man. It's
Love Asylum.
Everybody wants to be on that. Everybody wants to be on that show. Someone asked me the other day, would you do Love Island? For starters, Love Island's not going to have me. I'm the combined weight of everybody on Love Island. Number two,
so we can elevate
Love
Island.
Number two, I wouldn't do that to myself. I wouldn't put myself through psychological torture.
Psychological torture. That's the thing. Like, we'd love to see how much they're getting paid for it.
Fucking hell. They must be getting paid some money, man. But it's also so many people are saying, like, it's 8 or 10 million people in Britain alone watches that, and then fucking half Ireland's watched it, because all I see on Twitter and Instagram is that Love Island, Tommy Fury and all this, and it was like, jeez.
Oh, Tommy Fury on it, yes,
Tyson's brother,
yeah. What's the story with that?
He's mad, but you know what? He started off with 60,000 Instagram followers and he's 1.5 million now.
Did he?
Almost as much as Tyson, so it's good for his boxing career in that way.
Absolutely.
And you know what's going to happen? I make a prediction. I guarantee his first fight out, Frank Warren is going to make him a headliner straight away just because of that. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So if he decides to go down that route, but he might just see a different career now. You know what I mean? Modeling or whatever the fuck. It's all superficial shit for me, man. All that stuff. It's not what I would call nutrition for my soul.
Yeah.
So if it's not nutrition for my soul, I don't want to know about this. Like, you know, even just watching boxing or MMA is nutrition for my soul.
Yeah.
Figuring out shit and seeing things, training is nutrition for my soul. Spending time with my family is nutrition for my soul. Doing my art from creating, acting, writing is nutrition for my soul. I'm not gonna spend 1 hour watching fucking Love Island and basically regressing my intelligence. It's basically like drinking 10 pints and just losing, you know, a million brain cells. That's what it's like to me anyway. But other people out there want, look, listen, man, but you understand other people think differently, and you do a 9 to 5 and you just want to switch off, you know what I mean? But I see through this fakeness of these people. I can't watch.
Would your leg Tyson be shitting himself when he found out he's going on there?
I'd say, yeah. Oh, come here, listen, and you know Tyson's a mad born again Christian, and Tommy was kissing the fella and all that, so that might be a little bit of a family.
You didn't see that part,
yeah,
did
he was kissing the fella and all this, yeah, but listen, have the crack.
Well, right? Yeah, I'm
not giving a bollocks, you know what I mean? But interesting to see what the reaction is. Yeah, interesting within his family, you know.
Yeah, that's what I'd be thinking as well.
Yeah, and he's only 18 or 19. Like, he's a good looking fella. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. He's a handsome man.
Like,
he's a handsome
he looks
man.
Fucking more like a Spanish fella or something, or some cunt walking out a catwalk, doesn't he? Looks not like Tyson.
Must be them filters.
But he's a different mother than Tyson.
Oh, does he?
Yeah, so he's like, I think John Flory was a bit of a naughty man. I think there's like five different women he went on with, you know. So yeah, I think Tyson's mother is a gypsy woman from Belfast, and then I think his mother was an English woman or something like that. Yeah.
So, the last little while, we heard about the eviction of the sites.
Mm.
What's the story with this?
So there was a tender document released by the Dublin City Council, which it showed this plan, right? Now, when I say plan, it's important to highlight a plan. This wasn't something that was voted on. It wasn't a motion that was put forward that the council voted on.
Even for the council?
No. So it was just a plan that was put in place, which is funny, right? The first port of call with these newly elected councillors is to evict travellers on a mass scale from council land in the midst of the worst homeless crisis in the country's history since the famine, which was a genocide, by the way, anyway, but that's another issue.
It's another story, another day.
Yeah, so that in itself, forget about the discrimination and just targeting travellers and literally targeting them and saying this is designed for travellers and we've a security contract for €750,000 to employ security 7 days a week, and we're going to take the horses from them as well, which is one of the main tools we have for combating mental health, and we have the highest suicide rate in the world per capita of any people. 11% of us die through suicide. Just forget about all that, right? And they're big things to forget about.
Huge things.
But it just doesn't make sense.
No.
In the midst of the worst homeless crisis ever. Like, what? You're under so much pressure already. Like, we know you're faking your figures and there's over 10,000. There's more, probably 15,000 homeless. And we know way more that are living in their parents' couches and all this, that up to around 70 or 80,000 estimated, the different type of homelessness. Yeah. So it didn't make sense. So they released this document saying this was their plan, a direct action plan. They'll take travellers away from illegal encampments and whatever. They're living on council land, like we're living on council land. Now, people are living on social housing living on council land, and they're happy there. So if we're happy to live on council land, why don't you let us live the way we like on council land as well? Instead of, what are you going to do with us? Are you going to evict us all, and where are we going to go? Because I was under the impression there's no social housing, and the rent is the highest it's ever been. So where are we going to go? Is it a matter of fuck ye and you just go to the next district that run you out of Dublin and maybe go to a council in Kildare, someone else's problem, which is what the council have always done, by the way, with travellers. So what are you going to do? What's the solution? So I went on a media campaign and you reached out to me. Anthony Flynn reached out to me, another councillor. Larry O'Toole, my local councillor, Darren Dell's at Staunceville, another shinner. He reached out to me and whatever. I did a load of media and I got the message out there and whatever. And then there was a statement reply. Micheál McDonough, who's another shinner, he got in touch with someone in the council about this, and they got a reply saying, oh, there's no immediate action plan. So it was like they're backtracking because the media, there was an onslaught in the media, and I played my little part to play in that. But it's all up in the air, man, and we don't know what's happening. And what's happening within our community is so many travellers are terrified now. And when I put out this post, you want to see the amount of travellers hit me up from Dublin, like, they were going, John, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Like, this is our family home. What are children not going to be able to go to school? And do you know what we can do? Can you help us? Like, desperate. And they're still going on, even because your man replied to this email, but everything's not clear after what he said, because it's clear in the document what they want and what their intentions is, which is to take all travellers from so-called illegal encampments that could be there 2 decades on council land, and to remove them all from the land and take away the horses, which is a huge thing.
How many people are on your site, say, for land, the amount of land?
Well, look, put it this way, right? Where we moved in 2 decades ago was a wasteland in Darndale. No one wanted it, right? No one wanted it. But property developers now have been trying to get us out for the last 5 years, offering us money, and we've said no, right? And my grandfather, when he recently died, who was my hero, he said, the only way I'm leaving this place is in a box. And he did. He left it in a box. But we don't want to leave. And they're trying many different ways to get us going, you know? But you know they can't get us going easy because we're there 2 decades. But when we got there, it was a wasteland. No one wanted this place. We moved in, we met our own, we met everything our own. And down our lane alone, and we're just one lane that's a half a mile in length, there's probably 300-400 travellers, technically in illegal encampments. That's just one half mile lane in Coolock alone. Now, Coolock is the biggest population of travellers in any constituency. So God knows how many more dares to be evicted there if these plans go ahead. So if a lot of people terrified on my lane alone, everybody's going down to me and they're looking to me. And I have no choice but to be a leader here because I have
a voice
and to get out there. You know what I mean?
You are. Most leaders most good leaders are the ones that rise to the top unannounced themselves.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, man. Well,
someone that's at the bottom and says, I'm going to be the leader, usually fucks everybody on the way up.
100%. Well, I just go, I have a platform and I'm going to use it. I'm not going to see a load of traveller children get evicted.
It's your best weapon.
And taken away from their schools and taken away from their friends and their communities. This is wrong. Like, what sort of country are we living in, man? This is meant to be a free society. And we've already been treated so bad, and we've a terrible history with the council. The council were doing this to us for decades and decades. The council have been the travellers' biggest enemies, and the guards then have come in and always been the tool to, for the council. It's lucky now we're getting people like you in there and Anthony Flynn in there, yeah, and the Larry O'Toole's of the world. You know, lucky we have people in there who actually do, but we just don't have enough people. And the funny thing is, man, like, this council that we have is a largely left-wing council now. You know, with the Greens getting in and all this.
Which one?
This, like, no, the, like, in the, general, the, like, from council? All... From, no, because all four councils, is all their plans together. Well, they've all combined.
Well, a lot of these yeah, councils, though, we know the South Dublin County Council is now led by Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, and the Greens.
And
I can feel it.
I
guarantee it. Like,
but these people are meant to be about inclusiveness. We're meant to live in an inclusive Ireland, and the first stop is a mass eviction, and it just doesn't make sense to me. Like, man, we're left in a position where we're worried, and we're worried now it's going to come to our door, right? Now, if you look at some of the evictions that has already happened across Ireland, and Mead that time, and in Cavan, where they actually hired ex-loyalist paramilitaries. Now, with our country's history, ex-loyalist paramilitaries down fucking evicting our people. No, and then North Frederick Street. And then the Late Late had the bad idea to invite me on the Late Late Show during the Ireland's call run, and just to promote it, but to comment on the young Ireland panel, me and your man, the Gaelic footballer, I forget his name. And I said, you know what, I'm going to fuck shit up a bit here now and comment on what happened in North Frederick Street with the homeless people who went in there. And the loyalist paramilitaries there, and I said they're absolute fucking scumbags. And the guards who protected them were as well, because they had a moral choice, right? Because that went so big, they could have made a stance that could have changed the tide.
I just say, we're not standing there with that. No.
So when this all happened, that's what the first thing I thought, they're going to get a load of these loyalists again. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know who the security company is going to... But man, here's the thing, man. We're not going to take it, because our buttons have been pushed too much now. And we're not going to take it anymore. Like if you come to my... Like, my family... Only, I think we might have talked about this the last time. Like, an EDRU, the Emergency Response Unit, came into my family's camp with assault rifles and put my mother's head in a puddle, my two brothers, my two cousins, and a couple of my aunts and uncles, and threatened to blow their heads off without a search warrant. Had a search warrant for the next camp, right? And they're all in cahoots with the property developers. I know all this. I can almost prove it, but I have good circumstantial evidence anyway. They were trying to get us off anyway, right? Now, I wasn't there, and I swear to God, Paddy, I'm not trying to act like no hero, nothing like this, but the anger went through my body, man. I could have done bad things, man. And if I had been there, they would have had to blow my head off after seeing what done to me mother. Like, imagine hearing your mother got a gun put to her head. She's still jumpy. And that's two years ago. She's still jumpy over that. Still jumpy over that. She fucking aged 10 years over that. And if they come back again with guns, man, is all I can say is, if you bring a war to somebody, you're going to have to expect the war back. And that's the only way, but I don't want it to go there. And this is the biggest message I want to go out there is to the councils, is that what they don't understand is they've opened a can of worms, man, that they've no idea what they're doing. And this is gonna turn into something very nasty, that is going to be a bad stain in Ireland in this era, this modern era we're living in, if they don't come back from this plan. They need to be doing more to support us. Like, we were just talking off air there. Yeah. Like, what was it? Last year, I think it was only 52% of the councils, only 52% of council budgets in Ireland were spent, right? Which was high, usually, for the councils. So far this year, 14 councils have not spent the money.
So this means the money that's being sent, that
allocated specifically for travellers,
is not even bothered to be spent to improve the conditions.
Exactly. And that's high. 52% of the budget is high, usually it's like 20%. And so many councils don't spend €1.
Not even euro.
14 so far this year haven't spent €1. 3 rejected the budget altogether, didn't even want it.
They didn't want it.
Back in 1996, the EU demanded that Ireland build 3,500 traveller sites so we could live the way we want to live around their families. I think since there's probably been 200 sites built. This is a shame. Regularly, with the EU, the European Council of Human Rights, the UN and the EU have had damning reports about how travellers are treated in this country from a state level, and also showed studies where we're treated worse than any minority in the country. Right? This is over and over and over, and they don't care. they just don't care. There's an apathy there, and things are not going to change because this has been a dehumanizing project for travellers for so long. Like, if you look back to when the Free State was formed, right? This is where it all stemmed, because people want to know where the divide with travellers and settled came
from. This is what I was going to say to you. Like, this is additional discussion. Yeah. In the field of film, turns around and he says, back in the day, the travellers lost the grip on the land.
Mm. Yeah, so here's where it was. That's totally ideologically wrong. So if you listen, and anthropologically wrong. If you look at, in no point in human history has a people who are sedentary, settled, become nomadic, start to travel as a culture. That has never happened. It's been always the opposite, because we all come from hunter-gatherers, okay? Mm-hmm. So it's been when a nation has started to settle, right? And the Irish were one of the last nations to settle, last in Europe to settle. We were known as the Wandering Irish to the whole of Europe, not just to Britain, just 500 years ago. And then we had the reconquest of Ireland, because the original conquest did not work. The Brits did not fully de-Gaelicise us, because Gaelic culture revolved around community, looking after each other, but they wanted to create an individualism. And also Gaelic community revolved around travelling around, because 2/3 of the Irish population were nomadic. They travelled 500 years ago. But the Brits had to get the Irish to settle so they could pay taxes to king or queen. And they also had to make them individuals, break them up from family and Gaelic culture, so that they start being selfish, okay? And this was a part of the assimilation policies that were brought in. So the local sheriffs who were put in place by the monarchs had their scriptures, and they were allowed to kill someone who was travelling on the road and take everything they have and take all their belongings, but just take 33% for themselves. So they had a motive to kill somebody and to take, because they could take 33% and send it all back to the monarchs. So that huge travelling population of 2/3 of the population travelling became smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, and eventually became what we now know as travellers. That's where we come from, right? Okay. Which is an Irish thing to be travelling. It wasn't the question of when travellers start travelling, it's when settled people start settling. And this, I went through this in my 3-part documentary, where we talked to anthropologists, people who were we talked to the foremost expert in Gaelic Irish culture and traditions and customs, and these all confirmed it. Like, they were going, this is something that was obvious to people in our field for decades, but no one wanted to listen to us. And we looked at the origin and DNA testing, and if anybody's interested, it's called John Connor's The Travellers, and it's on the RTE player, and you can see the whole history, the culture, the origin, which is all about being Irish, actually. So what happened was, when the Free State was formed, in Dáil Éireann, they start talking about the politicians start talking about the ugly image of the tinker in the countryside that would deter foreign investment from America. Because don't forget, at that point, the country was being blown up to bits by the Civil War, and then we had a war of independence before that, in the 16 Rising, and what have you. So they started to bring in vagrancy acts and policies and laws and acts to try to stop travellers from travelling, and it wasn't working, and tried to get them to assimilate. And it all culminated in the 1963 report on itinerancy, and it was led by Charlie High. And in the report, Charlie High talked about we need the full absorption and assimilation of the itinerants into the settled population before there can be a final solution to the itinerant problem. Final solution 20 years after Nazi Germany, where we heard that famous line from Hitler. And problem, which is also what they called the Jews, the problem, we were called a problem. And in that commission, there was local councillors, elected TDs and ministers that made suggestions, like a solution could be to sterilise the women so they can't have kids, to castrate the men so they can't have kids, another fella said, put them all out in Spike Island and let them breed out as a population. Another person said, take away all their kids so there's one less in the itinerant class. These were suggestions that were not exactly enacted, but made by councillors, man. And no travellers had any input in this.
So there would have been no traveller on the council at that time, no?
Not at all. So this was their big way of dealing with travellers. So then what happened was, the tin smitten trade, the main thing we had for income was tin smitten, right? Yep. And using the old buckets and pans and selling them off to the farmers and people and what have you, which is better for the environment than plastic, say, right? But what happened was, plastic came in the early 60s and it obliterated the tin smitten trade overnight. So a lot of travellers lost a lot of income overnight. So the government saw this as a very smart move to go, right, this is what we can deal with the Travers. Travers lived in rural Ireland mostly. They stayed away from Dublin and the big cities because under colonisation, a lot of the Brits were in the big cities and they would have took the women, raped them, kids, all this kind of things, you know. So they stayed away from big cities and just went rural Ireland, travelling with the stories and songs and keeping traditional music alive, which a lot of great heroes like Christy Moore and Luke Kelly said, Travers kept it alive, you know.
Absolutely, yeah. So
what happened was they went, this is an opportunity to settle Travers and bring in an assimilation policy. So for the first time, Travers were offered a dole. This was in the mid-60s, 63 or 4. They were offered a dole for the first time if they all came to Dublin, right? So they put them in Dublin with other traveller families they never travelled with, didn't know, all together in sites like Cherry Orchard was one of them in Ballyfermot, and some of my family went there, and they got a percentage of the dole that settled people got, only, and then they get the full dole when they're 18 months settled in order to settle them. This is the assimilation policies. But the funny thing is, they wanted them to assimilate and become settled people, but yet they always put us on the edge of towns, edge of cities, edge of suburbs, always a gap between us and settled people. So it was impossible to even integrate. Okay, so you had Cherry Orchard then where they were all put, but then they said, no, actually we don't want you in Cherry Orchard now. We want you to move and get out of our district and go to Fingal now and get out of here, which is what they done. They ran my family. And actually my grandmother's cousin, who was an old woman at the time, old Nan Donoghue, JCB went straight to her shin bone and snapped her leg in half, and they took over about 150 travellers out of that site in Cherry Orchard. Now listen to this site in Cherry Orchard, right? My granduncle Joe Donoghue was like the leader of the clan, right? And he was in the British World War War. He was in the World War II, a British soldier sniper against the Nazis, right? When he came back, he joined the IRA and went up to Donegal, and he came down then and became a leader down in Ballyfermot, and he was involved in the IRA and this, that, and the other, you know? And in that site, nearly every weekend, you'd have the Dubliners, you'd have the Furies, you'd have the Keenans, and you'd have all different famous Irish traditional music artists before they were all famous, before the big revolution of traditional music in the late 60s. This is the early 60s, and every weekend they'd be there in his hut, which he had a big tricolour in the back, and he was actually had an involvement in the blowing up of Nelson's Pillar. And apparently, I hear it was planned there. But they were, think about all these people. And Luke Kelly, I heard a great story about Luke Kelly, you know, because I would have been a huge Luke Kelly fan. All my life, I'm a huge Luke Kelly fan. But it was really heartfelt to hear this, you know. Everybody else is coming in, you know, all the other Dubliners and the Furies and all these different groups, whatever. And everybody would bring a load of drink and all, you know, because they'd have a big session for 2 days just playing music and all. Because my family were all musicians. They don't know who was in the McCanns, you know, on my mother's side. But when he'd come with a load of sweets every time for the children. About 100 kids, and he'd spend like about £2 maybe, which is huge money back then, on sweets, and he'd come in with boxes of sweets for the kids, and he'd give every child in the camp sweets, and he'd play with the kids for a few hours before he'd even go in and play music. And I heard this off Kevin Dunne, who was a cousin of mine, who's in his 60s now. He was one of the kids. He's in his 50s now. He was one of the kids that Luke Kelly used to get his sister.
I'm a huge fan of you.
But that just made me even love more, because it made sense though with his heart. You know?
Yeah, you can just see by him. Can't you know what I mean?
So there was this knock-on effect from all these evictions.
You see by the look of him that he's just like
he felt it in his music, man.
Yeah,
you know?
That's what I mean. Yeah.
He felt it in his music.
My uncle was 8 months, and he goes to sleep listening to Luke.
Yeah, so he was Luke was a big proponent of Travers, you know, and he always talked about how Travers saved traditional music, you know, and Ronnie Drew did it, and Christy Moore did as well, and the Clancy's did and all that. So there was this knock-on effect. So I was sort of born into the next generation who were already settled, and we're being told about things on the road, being on the road in the life, and this is not the way we're meant to be born, and a 20-foot wall around us, and my grandmother's telling me we didn't have these walls, we were free, we're on the road, he took it away from us. So I was born into that, and then we felt like we were less than the generation before. And this is when the suicide rates start going. And if you look at any people in any community in the world where you remove their identity, it's the worst thing you can happen as an individual. Yeah. The Indigenous American people in Canada, the same, in the Aboriginal community, the Maori people, and they were all nomadism, the same as us, was taken away from them. And the suicide rate goes through the roof, alcoholism, all that. And you see all these problems. So then you get people who just go, you know, they tweet me and they go, hey, John, I'm sick of you giving out about travel discrimination. A traveller robbed a dog on me before in Kilkenny. What are you going to do about that? And I have to answer for every little traveller discretion. No. But they have no understanding of context, because with every action, there's a reaction, right? And a lot of the problems we're having with travellers, there are problems, man. But like, if you look at the traveller unemployment rate is 80%. But yet 83% of employers that were polled said they wouldn't employ a traveller. Hello, there's
makes
a direct
no
correlation
sense.
There.
Makes no sense,
you know what I mean? And also, if we have these Irish
you
liberal.
You have 83 saying no, and you have 83 in unemployment,
yeah,
then.
Exactly. And if these Irish liberal fake libs talking about Black Lives Matter and talking about, you know, black people are incarcerated, more of them is incarcerated now than in slavery, which is insane. And I go, that's insane. But then yet travellers are massively overrepresented in prison, but oh no, it's our fault.
When it's further away, people like it's, I don't say it's easy to kind of
but it's part of their ideology. The thing is, we've been dehumanized over generations. I mean, like you had judges calling us knackers, sentencing and calling us knackers. You know, you had politicians like the Fine Gael fella in 1997 said travellers have to be tagged like dogs, you know. There's a whistleblower came out 5-6 years ago. A traveller family were pulled up on the side of a road, and a guard pulls him in, and everything on the car and what have you. But he takes the name of the kid. The kid was a year old, but turns out the kid was on the criminal database, considered a criminal from birth. So it came out that they were traveller children were put on the criminal database from birth. Imagine your child being put in the criminal database from birth. I had a cousin, Aaron Joyce, whose body was refused from his local funeral home when he died. He died of a liver disease, kidney disease, and he refused his body because he was a traveller. And then you wonder why we're angry, because we've no voice.
Do we need a congress between travellers and settled people?
100%,
right?
It's essential.
Because I do feel this, right? Because I see this as well with the same thing that's going on, with the same thing when you're tweeting and people are tweeting this. And the biggest things that come up with that, travellers pay no tax. Mm. People will say that. So what is the situation with this?
The situation is, how, if you're 80% unemployed, you're not going to be paying tax. And it goes back to the poll we just showed where 83% of
that's
employers.
That's what I wanted to say.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, so if you've got 20%.
So the 20% pay tax, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, that's what I was saying. Like, so. But is that just one of them things that's able to kind of easy to smear somebody in a way, like where the situation is 80% employed, but they don't pay tax.
Yeah, man, I suppose...
Because it's very easy to annoy, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
People that wouldn't be annoyed by anyone, the people that would get on with a lot of people, but then get pissed off by tax.
I know, man, I suppose, like, here's the thing, man, life is fucking hard, right? And people at the bottom fight with each other.
Yes.
And they realise that there's one thing happening, that the people at the top are actually fucking us all. But let's all us continue fighting amongst each other. And this has been the biggest frustration for me, where I'm looking at working class people discriminating against travellers, and I'm going, what is wrong with you? And then travellers do it as well. And what happens is, when you grow up in fear, right? So if you're a settled person and you read the newspaper and we're animals and you're being told and you hear this story and whatever, you build up this idea of the boogeyman, okay? And they're the boogeyman. And when you meet the boogeyman, you're only looking to confirm your own bias, okay? Your own feelings. You're not looking to learn. And the exact same with travellers. When they hear the boogeyman, the settled person or whatever. So you have a traveller and a settled person meeting who are both in fear of each other and both want to confirm their own bias. They're only going to confirm their own bias because they're not open-minded. And this is brainwashing. This is propaganda.
Yeah, exactly.
It all comes from the media. This is propaganda. So until we get a genuine, like, we have it in Coolock, like where I face loads of discrimination in Coolock, but also loads of settled people who I get along with. Like, my two best friends are settled people. My best friends in the world, like, you know what I mean? And then I have my whole family who are all my friends, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But so there needs to be more dialogue, but we need to kind of figure out that we need to support each other more as well, man. And travellers have as much to go as settled people have to go as well.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Because this is what I mean.
It's a two-way street.
If we was involved in the community, right, and I think, I won't say your community is small, but compared to small community.
Well, there's more Muslims in the country than travellers. There's more Chinese in the country than travellers. There's more Polish than travellers.
Let's say the Muslim community now. I love the Muslim community. I think the Muslim community is being great, man.
Yeah.
I've been over in the what's it, the mosque over in Clonsilla? One of the kids that trained here was stabbed in a park. It was terrible, man. But you could see the whole lot of them all together. And I've seen this with travellers as well.
Yeah.
I've never seen hurt in people after dying than I've seen in travelling families.
So
and it could be just a chance that I was at my granddad's grave that day, and you'd see a traveller would be getting buried, and you would see the family.
Yeah.
Distraught, like beyond, like, and that love and that kind of sorrow and power and pain that's in there. Like, I think that settled people feel a lot like travellers in this way, yeah, especially people. We're all oppressed
of
in
course,
this way,
man, yeah.
And I think that the link needs to be. So I was telling you before we got on here as well. So I'm at the linking in with the local the traveller community in our place, right? And yeah, we've organised a like a save yourself kind of thing.
Yeah,
so it's
yeah,
a 3-day yoke, right? One of them is you do. So it's going to be a course that we're going to run for. It's going to be advertised soon. So the idea is that you do 8 weeks of jiu-jitsu. So I think for the travelling community, bring them totally out
brilliant,
of what would be...
Brilliant, and get them away from boxing.
Absolutely,
else,
traditionally
you know
boxing, show them a few slangles.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. You're going to tool them up.
You're going to regret this? Yeah, come in then, boys.
You'll be strangling the locals.
Trying to have the developers coming in to take the sides then. They're all asleep.
Perfect. Get them in a chokehold.
So one day you do that, and then one day we decide they learn a cooking thing.
Yeah.
So how, learn how to make a meal, yeah, learn how to go back and make a meal for that family.
And that it's okay to cook as a man.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
And we wanna,
this thing of masculinity,
I
not being
break
afraid of it.
All of this,
yeah,
shit.
Yeah.
That one I do, because yeah, because I know that when I met him with the groups, and I've been bouncing off this guy named Alan, and he's a manager up in the travelling centre,
yeah,
and he's a settled lad as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've met him with the mothers that travel, and it's
yeah,
lovely giving you hugs and
yeah,
you want a cup of tea,
yeah,
son, and
yeah,
just a great energy. Now I've been
yeah,
around it for a little while now,
yeah,
it's brilliant.
I love it.
But the idea of, as you're saying, he comes and he says some things to me, I'm not going to be able to do this because of this, I'm not going to,
yeah, there's cultural
like,
things
yeah,
that yeah,
and
he thinks that he can't break down,
yeah, but
you have to push them,
let's have a talk of it,
yeah, no, you have to push
you
them,
know what I mean? So
you're totally
the,
right,
the chimp paradox, right? So
yeah,
I'm going to go in and the boys will, I think the boys will get me, you know what I mean,
100%.
As you said,
you're a traveller,
you think you're a traveller,
you're a traveller, I'm telling you. The hen, yeah. I can see you selling a lot of carpet in a high-ass van.
That's what I used to do. I own a high-ass.
With about 50 children in the back.
Do you know what's mad? I said to
him. You have a lot of children as well.
Two of
them. Yeah, you do, yeah. Oh, you want a lot of children.
Yeah,
yeah,
no, I want loads.
Yeah,
what
yeah,
are you saying to her as well? I feel good in a van.
Yeah,
I think
yeah,
I'll get a van.
Yeah.
She's like, why?
Ah, oh, it's sealed.
There's
then
only
the
three
deal is
seats,
done.
And I'm like, I love a van.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And then, one of the days is that we're working in with a Wim Hof coach.
Yeah,
so a guy that's going to learn how to do cold water treatment. So what I want to do is I want to take a few traveling lads, because I grew up with us.
And that's something
on,
very different for them to do that, man. Yeah,
you know
you need
I mean?
To take them out of their comfort
absolutely,
zone. You're totally
and
right.
And I want to get 12.
No point doing the same old thing.
No, I don't want to get 12 lads that are literally like, you know, we need something. And this is it.
Yeah.
And then when they go back to the site or they go back to
yeah,
they say, do you know what?
Yeah.
There's boys out there in the sound.
Cause ripple effect.
And then what I'm going to try and do is I'm going to try and link the communities.
Yeah.
So we do 12 and 12.
Yeah.
So you can imagine a settled lad and a travelling lad
yeah,
out there on the mat doing
yeah,
jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
Or a settled lad and a travelling lad having
integration.
To go into the integration. So
it's so important.
We've been doing it with the North called Fight to Unite.
Yeah.
So we're Protestants and Catholics. And I've done a course in cross borders communications, which
yeah,
I lived with.
Yeah.
So I lived with 8 Catholics. I lived with 8 Protestants and 8
deadly,
people.
Jeez,
right?
Yeah.
So they were great. I got to
that's
I went to Canada and all, and stay in Canada with
wow,
them,
man.
And we studied together, and we went back and forth. We lived up there for 8 weeks, and then we lived in Canada for months, and it was brilliant. So
that's
we done it two. I done it off a course that I done, but it was one of the best things I ever did. Now, and then being in Northern Ireland as well, I knew what to expect. But a lot of the shitheads were the settled lads. That was the southern lads.
Yeah,
you know
yeah,
what I mean?
The southern lads.
The southern
yeah,
lads were
yeah,
like.
Yeah.
Some of them are all right. I know
yeah,
not, but listen,
their own little natural biasness, man.
And they'll tell you yeah, straight, like, yeah, he did say I was a shithead. So
yeah,
long money, it's
yeah,
not.
Yeah.
I wasn't meant to slide there. I probably told
you.
You
know the thing
is,
man, we also have to not be afraid, man, to offend each other either, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and not be pranced around things and worried about what we say and things like that. We have to learn to not take things personal. You know what I mean? Like, and just if someone says something, that's it. Let just we all learn from each other, because we're in the generation now of people getting offended. Like,
absolutely,
people getting offended fucking for like I don't know how many thousand people I've offended now. And you know, it's got these cunts have made me like offending people. I do things deliberately to offend people now. That I don't call the snowflakes, but I come up with a new word because snowflakes, because they annoy me so much. Snowflakes is not a good enough word to describe them, because
really?
It's not giving you enough satisfaction. So I come up with a new word, and I'm pretty sure I invented this, man. I'm pretty sure I did, and it's called cuntflakes. Because if you think about it, man, it gets the aggression out of you more. Cuntflakes.
It sounds disgusting.
Yeah, so they're cuntflakes. Yeah. So these are cuntflakes, man. And they get offended and they play the oppression Olympics, you know.
Right.
And just because you're this, you're oppressed and this
and
is my holiday.
And settled people,
it's,
and travellers.
Yeah, yeah, everybody. You know, they're the Twitter crowd as well, like. And they're just fucking ridiculous, man. they're absolutely ridiculous. They get offended over everything. They pick up everything, man. And they're never going to get anywhere in life, man, for getting offended all the time. Stop being fucking offended. No, like, I'm offended. I don't give a shit if you're offended.
Yeah, I bet you they never thought that they'd be looking down a situation that we'd have, like people are going on about the EU and all, like, fuck the EU. And I'm telling you, it's right here, right now. If we weren't part of the EU now, they would just come in and pillage your country. That's just the way it is. If we had the EU back in the
Our advantage of being part of the EU now
is that we have a big brother.
I'm against the EU. I'll tell you our advantage is in these negotiations is that it's going to cause, because we're part of the EU and because up north voted majority EU, where it's going to cause a United Ireland.
Yes.
This is what the advantage is now. But once that happens, I want out of the EU. I'm anti-EU. Fuck the EU. That's what I say. They built us a few roads and signs. Fuck them, the cunts. Yeah.
Now, the thing is about, if we get started with the bill, because Ireland owed 200 billion.
They put the bill onto us, man.
200 billion.
They made us pay the majority of the banking crisis debt. But why? Because they bullied us. But we were bullied.
That, but if and that would then, if like, we didn't even change the power party after that, so if and that's our own fucking fault.
I know, but we've no power anyway. We voted against the Lisbon Treaty, they made us vote again. A lot of fellas come over in suits and briefcases. We were bullied. We're getting bullied all along. They control our laws, our tax systems. They control borders. They control everything.
The tax system, in a way, they don't control it so much, John, because if they did,
they still have the pass on it.
Yeah, but our corporate tax is 12.5%, which is the lowest in all of Europe. Poland is.
But even our taxes has to be signed off of them. How we want to distribute our own tax. The 12.5%. So look what they're trying to do, right? So the 12.5%. Apple owes 13 billion. But of course, the Irish government don't want to take the 13 billion.
But the EU told them to go get it.
I know. And do you know why the EU told them? Just because the EU want to bring the corporations over to other countries in the EU. That's the only reason. So like, we're getting them from all directions. We're getting the steel hammer on
top
of them.
But they're never going to leave our country because of our corporation tax. Well, that, like, even if we made them fucking pay it, that's still cheaper than everybody
still, because the 12.5% is lower than probably anywhere in Europe anyway.
90% is Poland, which is one of the closest.
But man, we need to, but listen, we need to find a different way, because letting all these foreign national companies come into the country, Google's, the Facebooks and all this, come into our country, and this 12.5% corporation tax, and then they're not even paying the full 12.5%. This is bollocks anyway. And I don't want Ireland to become a big corporate private company, which is we're en route to just becoming Ireland, the private company.
Yeah, it's, you know what I mean?
We need to build infrastructure, man.
And these companies become bigger than governments, you know what I mean? Because
they have to control the political clout and power.
But what people are going to say, right, because us saying this now 100%, because we get these messages after this, it would be like, you're a sap. If you don't know what you're talking about, two US travellers sitting there
talking politics.
Yeah.
But my advantage is I'm not involved in politics. That's my advantage. People always ask me, are you going to run?
You're next.
Yeah, run away from politics.
You're next.
Yeah,
you're
my
next.
I said the only way
you're going to be the traveller counsellor.
The only way I would ever get involved in politics, man, because acting is too much fun. Fuck that politics. The only way I am involved, but I'm just indirectly involved, right? But the only way I would run for president, if Peter Casey ran again, just to run against him, that'd be the only way. But if he doesn't run that,
and the final is get the box for it.
Yeah. And we know who'd win that one.
Peter's a good man.
Now Derry man is hard.
So people are going to be saying this, yeah, but them companies are going to leave. And like, I've got people that would message me out of these companies going, I'd have no job, and then I have to pay this and I have to pay that. And it's like, listen, 12.5% is what they have to pay. We're letting them bully us and run all over us, because the thing is, we have to pay mine. We pay my tax on the air, on the building, on whatever goes on.
And they don't pay. And they're worth fucking tens of billions. Starbucks last year paid nothing.
Nothing. Absolutely serious. And people would know these things.
Like, that 13 billion is just Apple. Imagine what Google and Facebook and Starbucks and all the other companies own. We probably have enough to take us out of fucking debt.
We are.
A debt that was forced on us
by
the EU.
We should be walking around in robes.
I know.
In
silk.
We're the sheep.
We should be like the Saudis over
there. Absolutely, we should be, with sun cream on.
For fuck's sake.
That's
man.
What we should be like, John. We should
fucking
be rocking
hell,
out.
I need to pay a fucking prescription. Old women have to pay a prescription.
I said last week on the podcast, I went to see a doctor and I still have the fucking chest infection. I'm going back for it, but me bleeding. Do you get what's it called, a Garrett Hart or something on that? Not on the chest infection.
Yeah.
€125 cost me, right?
Jesus,
see the doctor
Christ.
And get medication. I'm still sick.
Fucking hell.
If this was my car, I'd be going back.
That's what they do, is make you sick.
And if we went back in, I'd be like, oh, do you know what? It's a repeat prescription. Your woman says to me in the chemist, you want a repeat prescription? No, why would I want one of them? Yeah. That's like asking me when I'm going to buy a bucket of paint, do you want another bucket of paint? I'm starting to suspect about this fucking bucket of paint now. Am I going to need it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's crazy. Another thing on Twitter as well, the other day came up, right? When you hear this. And this Twitter's fucking mental, isn't it?
Yeah.
mental.
Twitter's full of fucking idiots, man.
Right, so the idea of the 12th of July the other day, right?
Yeah.
So we've got groups, small groups on this country, right? That if we run around, and start like screaming from the, now probably get loads of votes, Casey. If we start screaming about the traveller community and burning traveller flags and or they went to a different nation and start burning their flags. There's people born in the Irish flag on the island of Ireland and their fucking government says nothing about it. Like, we have a situation up the north, right, where there's the leisure centre and they built a fire. But not only that, the community have fortified it. The paramilitaries, which are the UVF in that area, have decided to threaten people and put it on the walls that if any of these private companies come in to take, like the private companies that will be coming in to, say, this
police travellers.
Take the police travellers. Yeah. These people that they're asking to come in, we're not going in anymore. Why? Because we're in fear of our life.
Well, man,
they
know.
We're talking about bonfires here.
The thing is, man, about them is that the unionist community and the loyalist community, they know the end is near.
Listen to this.
The United Ireland is inevitable.
Before we even go on, right? Listen to this, right? Because
today is the 11th of July, a day when many who make up the unionist and loyalist community on our island light bonfires to mark the anniversary of the Battle of the Boyne. Many of these events pass off without any great disruption to people's lives, but in some areas there are sure to be, as ever, incidents of hate crimes, with election posters belonging to Sinn Féin representatives burned, along with those members of the SDLP and the Alliance Party. In some instances, we have seen effigies of Sinn Féin representatives hung on these bonfires, and the tricolour, our national flag, is regularly burned on bonfires in some parts of the north. I think these instances would be considered hate crimes in anybody's book, and so-called cultural expression cannot be an excuse for some of the behaviour witnessed over the 12th period. So can I ask you, Tánaiste, that you join with me in condemning all acts of hatred and sectarianism, and to join me in calling on the leadership of the Orange Order, other loyal orders, and the leadership of political unionism to take a stand against these kind of acts.
Yeah, Deputy, this is a very sensitive time of year in Northern Ireland, as you know well. It's the eve of the 12th of July, which is a period, particularly for many in the unionist community, of recognition of tradition, identity, and many other emotive and powerful influencers within communities. But I think there is a responsibility on all of us, but also on all communities in Northern Ireland.
Where's the responsibility on all of us?
That expression of identity doesn't spill over into hatred.
Do you know what the maddest thing is? This is the maddest thing of the whole thing, okay? The tricolour, the Irish tricolour, is the greatest flag on planet Earth, and I'll tell you why. Because it's green, white and orange, not gold. Okay, the green is Catholicism, the white is peace, and the orange is Protestants. Okay, it's about Protestants and Catholics coming together in peace. That's a beautiful symbol. That's the symbol for United Ireland, for the reunification of Ireland. And they're burning that without realising. You know, that celebrates, that orange celebrates them as well. And I'm one of these people who wants a United Ireland, yeah. A new United Ireland, and I mean this. I'm not one of these people that go, I want a United Ireland for everybody, you know, except the unionists when they come in. No, I want them to be a part of United Ireland.
Me too.
And to maintain their culture if they want, 100%. Yeah, 100%. And I mean that, and so any real Republican means that. But they have to...
Because we understand tradition, that's why.
The funniest thing ever is, man, like working class now, so Catholics up north from a nationalist background, Republican background, are better educated now and are in a higher employment, higher positions of employment now than their Protestant counterparts, working class particularly, okay? And the reason why is because they still have the UVF, UDA sort of structure within the communities over there. We have to ask permission if you want to do a party for the UDA head to give you permission and all. They still have that. They didn't develop their community. So immediately after the Good Friday Agreement and before that, the Republicans straight away start developing their communities, start putting political classes in into their for the youth in the local communities, integrate all this sort of stuff and educated them and enlightened them and awoke the people. This is what the Republicans did. So the Protestants and counterparts have sort of have regressed, right? And the funniest thing is, these are poor working class people, right? And the poor working class people were always the ones that were used by empire. Yet the worship this like it's the altar of God, this thing of empire, when it's the working class people who are screwed over by empire. The working class people from Liverpool, Manchester, London are put to the front lines of the empire and killed and enslaved by them. You know, these are the people, they don't realize that empire was not a good thing for them. But unfortunately, culture is a thing that is bestowed on us from birth, and it's what we're bred into, and it's what they believe that they have to fight for that, you know. But it's gone now, and it's ironically Brexit is what's going to cause United Ireland, and that's that the breakup of the United Kingdom.
That's the whole situation where Britain is literally just going to be on its own again. And I think that's what they want, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I think at this stage now, they know empire is over. I think there's a lot of English nationalists now that just want an individual England. And let's face it, like, man, they were the main perpetrators within the British system, you know. I mean, Scotland formed the Act of Union because Scotland actually themselves wanted to be a colonial power and went to Panama and tried to colonise Panama. Got there too late, realised the Spanish were already there. They lost half their fleet to the flu and spent a fifth of the country's wealth to national treasury. So what happened was England came in and bailed them out and says, we'll give you back that money if you join the Union, the United Kingdom. And Scott, that's how Scott, like people always say the Scots and the Irish are the same. Not exactly.
Not exactly.
We were colonised and they weren't. They joined the Union with their own free will, and were, you know, and a lot of them were higher ranked up as well within the British system, you know. But the English were the main perpetrators. We noticed the English state, not the people, the state. And I think
independence was tested just there not too long ago with a vote for independence.
Yeah, absolutely. So they want to be taken out of the EU, but obviously they're split up in that Wales and England. Wales and England wanted to get out, but Scotland and the north of Ireland, the six counties, wanted to stay in. So I think it's going to mean the split of the United Kingdom. We're going to see a separate England, Wales, Scotland, and a United Ireland. That's what we're going to see, I'd say, within 5 years.
And I think that benefit, like, people don't understand it. That benefits us so much. Like,
usually.
Well, there's in Ireland that you can communicate with and do business.
Oh, man,
with,
it doesn't make sense having two economies in one island.
Oh.
That does not make sense. Like, there was a study done in Toronto, the same university that done a study on North and South Korea, and also East and West Berlin. And it was an economical study, nothing else, no political narrative going through, just a basic economic study where it said that it would never make sense to have two economies on the same island, and that a reunification of Ireland would mean a 38 billion boost to the Irish economy in the first 8 years.
That's what we've heard, yeah.
For everybody on the island.
Yeah, everybody.
So that goes against the narrative we were always told by Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil, who are two cheeks of the same arse, who told us we can't afford to take the North. Yeah. It's actually the exact opposite. We can't afford not to take the North back.
Absolutely.
That's a reality. And people need to start hearing that message, because these are the conversations we have to have if we're gonna have independence.
And we have to be ready for what they're going to do as the scaremonger from the start, because they did it in Scotland as well. Scotland was like, you're going to, like, to all the old people, you're
the whole
lose
establishment.
Your pensions, you're going to lose this.
The BBC did that as well. They were a huge part of that, and the BBC were biased. Their studies showed how biased they were as well. RTE are going to do the same, and this is why. Because RTE are Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael, they switch back and forward essentially, right? Fianna Fáil or Fine Gael don't want a United Ireland, and the reason why they don't want a United Ireland is because there's a huge constituency of people up there are Sinn Féin voters.
Yeah,
and it's going to mean that Sinn Féin are the biggest party on the island. That's
they're
what
gonna
it's
going to get
gonna,
a big
it's going to mean that.
It's a flood.
So they don't want Sinn Féin to be the main party on the island, so they're going to go against that, and RTE are going to report biased media against that. And
listen,
you know what I mean?
I know that.
You know?
And the thing is, I think people are starting to get way to that, which is a good
thing. Yeah, let's get rid of the V.
But it's the same thing with taxes as well. Like, I don't mind paying taxes, but I want my fucking taxes.
Yeah.
Get you for that.
To go somewhere.
Yeah, where
your taxes to fucking go somewhere.
Bits, you know?
Yeah,
what I mean?
Man.
They
where's our social housing?
But what if we want to get down to the hospital there, right? If something happens to me, if I'm sick, right? You pay me taxes for the hospital, for the roads, for all of that kind of other stuff and all. Like, and it's like, they put you into a situation where it's a marathon. It's like, you will quit before you get to the end of this and you'll go private because it's a 14-hour thing. And whoever does the stints does it, you know?
Man,
what I mean?
I've often been in the emergency room for 16 hours. Like, 16 fucking
it's
hours.
Ridiculous, isn't it?
It's fucking
it's
mad.
Ridiculous. Nobody should.
Hear my belly grumble there.
Yeah. 16 hour waiting rooms and 14 years for housing.
Oh,
do you know what I mean?
565,000 people outpatients waiting on hospital on the hospital waiting. It's 565,000.
That's ridiculous.
What?
Ridiculous.
A new figure just came out. Hello, people. Wake up. Wake up before Ireland's gone.
On a mad little left situation, did you see about the Lazar thing that we were talking about? Did you see about the man Lazar?
Is he that big muscle bag?
No, he's
though, the alien.
So this fella, he walked in Area 21, right? Yeah, that's
it. He was on the Rogan podcast.
He was talking about like seeing spaceships in there, slow stuff. Done 4 polygraphs, right? Passed them all.
Did he pass them?
Passed 4 of them.
Fuck off.
All different.
Didn't he saw an actual alien on a table?
He said that, he said sitting
that
there.
They were operating
a conversation.
On.
Mad shit, he said he's saying, right? But did you see the yokes that are coming up?
Was that?
There's a thing on Facebook where 400,000 people are now planning to storm Area 51.
Fuck off.
I swear to God,
way.
And Joe Rogan even this morning asking them, like,
"Oh, alien freaks.
Don't do that.
Want to know. Do you know how to be shot down,
they'd
man?
They'd be lashed down.
The most powerful military in
absolutely.
Human history.
Absolutely. They'd shoot them, man. They won't even be.
They'd be obliterated.
They would have never been even born.
Jesus, man. That's mad. That fascinated me, actually, that podcast, man. I was like, what
that
the fuck
messed
do we
up,
not know?
I know.
You know what I mean? This fella's telling the truth there. And it showed up that he did work for them, and they covered it up, and they proved that. And you're like, what? And this fella's saying this 30 something years, and no one's listening to him. Well, only now people are starting to listen.
And
to
his
him.
Life and all is in danger.
And loads of these things have come out to be true. All the things he said over the decades.
The one thing he said about on the periodic table that there was going to be another element years back and all.
Years
now
back.
Now there is.
And now there is. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
So like,
it's mad, man.
It sounds like
fascinating.
I love that shit.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be back next week because I've been zapped at Area 51.
Yeah. He's like, we organised that meeting.
Spoiler.
Put it on, boys. We leave it at that week.
Yeah, man.
That was fucking
nice one, brother. Nice one.
So much, and I never need, you know.
Yeah, thank you, but I know, and I really appreciate it because when I put out that media call, you were one of the first to reach out, and I was Brad and Robin and that. So thanks very much, lads.
It's
good to get the message out.
And the biggest thing that we all have, that's what we need.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing we all have, but I tell you a mad story as well, right? Because I'm going to, can I try get this television back from you, right?
Yeah.
Your cousin works for Harvey Norman, tell you, on the end of another day, right? And the other day, right? Two traveling lads walked up to him and said, let's feel away that telly. Just to feel away of it. Two of them walked off. I said to him, you're a fucking idiot. I was like, why? I was like, you let them feel the weight of the television, gee, right?
Why would they feel the weight of it?
But then, you know what I did ask him, in fairness, right? If it was two settled lads, would you say the same? Two settled lads walked up to me. He's like, no, I wouldn't. I was like, well, don't say two travelling lads.
Yeah.
That was no shame, right? Look after yourself.
Stop.
3 grand, Teddy was worth.